From the 1st of January, the NPR is already being piloted in Karnataka. It's already begun, and it is it is scheduled to start in the rest of the country from the 1st of April. We don't have time. We need to understand, and we need. It is a much greater threat. The Assam. We had many problems with many of us had problems with what happened for many years in Assam, but Assam was never a communal project. I mean, for me to imagine Mr. Adityanath's government deciding based on a population register who is a doubtful citizen at the level of the tehsildar, it is terrifying. And I think we need to recognize it. Now, where is all of this going to be resolved? Our refugee policy, whether we'll have a national register of citizens, whether the NPR is a process, is it going to be resolved in parliament? We've seen political parties across the spectrum, and in this case, barring specifically and honorably the left, we've seen them very shaky in their moral convictions through this entire process. We've seen them making cynical compromises for immediate political ends. And at some level, uplifting observation that they are now following our young people rather than leading them. So after the protests across the country, we hear Mr. Naveen Patnaik, we hear Mr. Reddy, we hear all sorts of people, and even Mr. Nitish Kumar now saying they won't have an NRC. But given the record that they have so far, I do not think that we can have faith that these issues are going to be resolved in Parliament. Now, where's the second place it can be resolved? And that is in our higher courts. And we must approach them. We must approach the Supreme Court. I am one of many petitioners who have challenged the CAA. But I would like to say again very clearly that the working of the Supreme Court in recent years, and it's important that for a democracy, for a majority in a democracy to not turn majoritarian, the Supreme Court has a very critical role. The judiciary has a very critical role. And I think they have failed India's minorities in recent months and years over and over again in the Ayodhya judgment, in how they responded to Kashmir, in how they responded to habeas corpus petitions on Kashmir, on how they responded to petitions about students being beaten up in Aligarh and Jamia. So we will approach the Supreme Court, but I don't think, and in the end, it is not, I don't think this issue is going to be decided by, was it a reasonable classification, was it not a reasonable classification? It's not a question of legalese that is at stake at this moment, as all of us have been clear about. The third place that it is going to get resolved, I think, is on the streets. And the battle is being fought, and it's being fought in ways that are inspiring for all of us. But I think that there's a fourth place where ultimately this battle is going to be resolved. And that is in your and my hearts. Because it is in the end a question of whether we have allowed hatred against people based on their identities to be colonized in our hearts in the way that has been the project of the ruling establishment over the last 5 or 6 years. And ultimately, I think it is going to be resolved, as I said, not in Parliament, not in the courts, not even on the streets, but in our hearts. And I think that's where this battle has to be most of all fought. The last thing that I wanted to say before we open up to questions is the question of civil disobedience. And many of us across the country are learning, relearning, and young people, it's exciting again to see them relearn what Mahatma Gandhi taught us. If you're faced with a law which is unjust and ruinous, disobey it, he told us, but disobey it publicly and performatively, almost like utsav jaisa, in the way that He went to make a fistful of salt, and it became the most iconic moment in our freedom struggle. But there's another part to what he taught us, and that is that there's no point in civil disobedience unless you demand punishment for yourself. So Mahatma Gandhi went to jail for a year for making a fistful of salt, and 60,000 other Indians went to jail with him after they made salt. And I do believe that this is a moment which calls for civil disobedience of that scale, demanding that if anyone is stripped of citizenship rights, if anyone is sent, any of my sisters or brothers are sent to a detention center, it must happen to me as well. And hum kagaz nahi dikhayenge. But the trouble with hum kagaz nahi dikhayenge for a non-Muslim will have absolutely very different consequences from hum kagaz nahi dikhayenge for a Muslim. And how do we all stand together? The last complication in the civil disobedience is the NPR. Because if the NPR is implemented as part of the census operations, as I believe it may well be, how do we then respond? How do we tell our state governments? So the Kerala government has done something very brave and I think very, very important. But it has done an act of civil disobedience. And it is a constitutional crisis. The central government is within its authority to do what it is doing in a very strict legal sense. And the state government is saying, we won't cooperate, we won't give our state machinery. Now, if many states do this, the central government is in its rights to dismiss these governments under Article 356, and then will there be another election, and then how many governments will they dismiss, and how many times will they dismiss them, is, I think, a form of civil disobedience for the federal structure that we are going to see possibly unfold. But the complication is, and that's what I want to leave you, is that what happens about the census? Now, if somebody comes into my house and says, I ask me a set of questions, can I say I'm answering them to you for the census but not for the NPR? How is that going to work out? Is something that I think we need to think about in this process of civil disobedience. And I do believe that we have to say that as long as you have tainted the census with the NPR, we boycott also the census.